بسم الله، والحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. أما بعد، This is our third lesson going through the book المقدمة هلاج الرومية في علم النحو. The date is the 14th of Dhul-Hijjah 1441, which corresponds to Tuesday the 4th of August 2020. In this lesson, inshallah, we are going to be discussing issues pertaining to Al-Iraab. We're going to define it, right? And then we're going to discuss the categories of Al-Iraab. So the definition of Al-Iraab consists of four points. The first point is that there's a changing that takes place. That's the first point. There's a taghir. Taghir of what? Changing of what? Changing at the endings of words. So what's being changed is the endings of the word, of the Arabic word. And this change could either be explicit or implicit. And the reason why this change occurs is due to differences in the factors that enter upon said word. And so you have a word like Zayd. I can put it in three different scenarios and the ending of that word will change. جَاءَ زَيْدٌ رَأَيْتُ زَيْدًا مَرَرْتُ بِزَيْدٍ I put it in three different contexts, and because of these factors I've entered upon it, in each case, the ending of the word changed. And this change is explicit. You can actually hear it. Right? It's clear. طيب جَاءَ زَيْدٌ مَرَرْتُ بِزَيْدٍ رَأَيْتُ زَيْدًا It's explicit. طيب. And in each scenario, I put it in a different case. I put it under the influence of another external factor. And in each external factor that I put it under, what happened was the ending of the word changed. I cannot give you another example where the changing also occurs, but it's not explicit, but implicit. Like, جاء الفتى, رأيت الفتى, مررت بالفتى. I put the word فتى in the same scenarios that I put زيد in. However, the changing, it does occur, and the changing does occur at the ending of the word, but what's happening here is that it's implicit. The changing is not explicit. It is taqdiri, not lafzi. And so here you can see an example of explicit i'rab. Ja'a zaydun. Zaydun here is a fa'il, and we'll see what a fa'il is later. And so the fa'il will be marfu', and the sign of raf', as we'll see later, is what? Dhamma. Likewise, in the second example, مَرَرْتُ بِزَيْدٍ Zayd here is a ism majrur, due to the harf jar, the ba that precedes it. And we know the jar, or the ism majrur, the primary sign for it, as we'll see later, inshallah, is the kasra. طيب. Likewise, in the third example, رَأَيْتُ زَيْدًا Zaydan here is in the maf'ul bihi. It's a maf'ul bihi. And we'll see that the maf'ul bihi, it is from the mansubat. And the mansubat, the primary sign for it is a fatha. And so here you can see the same word, Zayd. I've put it under three separate scenarios. جَاءَ زَيْدٌ مَرَرْتُ بِزَيْدٍ رَأَيْتُ زَيْدًا This is an example of explicit i'rab. This table summarizes for us implicit i'rab. And so the reason why there is something called implicit i'rab is because something, and they are one of three, prevents the haraka, which could be either a dhamma, a kasra, or a fatha, from being made explicitly clear. Like in the example of Zaydun and Zaydan and Bizaydin, right? Nothing is there to prevent the haraka, the dhamma, the kasra, the fatah from being made explicitly clear for you to see that this word is in the state of raf'a or in the state of nasb or in the state of jar. However, there are three things. If they are found in the word, they may prevent the haraka from becoming made explicitly clear. And so there is i'rab taking place. So when you put it in those three contexts, i.e. the state of raf'a, nasb or jar, there is a change. There is an i'rab taking place, but this change is it's implicit. It is not explicit. And so what are these three points? The first point is what we call at-ta'adhur. And so if you have a word and the ending of it is an alif maqsura, طيب, this alif has to necessarily be in the state of sukun. And so it can't accept a dhamma or a kasra or a fatha. You can't make a fatha, a kasra, or a dhamma explicitly clear. طيب. And so example of fata. Fata, the word fata, which means young boy, it ends with a alif maqsura, right? This alif maqsura cannot accept a dhamma. It cannot make a dhamma explicitly clear. Neither can it make a kasra explicitly clear. Neither can it make a fatha explicitly clear. However, when you put it in the case of rafa, it's going to be marfu. If you put it in the case of nasb, it's going to be mansub. If you put it in the case of خفض أو جر it will be مجرور. For example, جاء الفتى. طيب الفتى هي is a فاعل and the فاعل is مرفوع. However, the sign of رفع here it's an implicit ضمة. What prevented the dhamma from becoming explicit is what we call at-ta'adhur, the inability of the dhamma to be placed upon the alif here, and due to this alif being present at the end of this word, it prevented the dhamma from becoming explicitly clear, and so therefore we say the dhamma here is what? It's implied. It is implicit. Likewise, marartu bil fata. Al-fata here, it is a ism majrur. وعلامة جره الكسرة المقدرة. And the sign of jar here is a kasra. But the kasra here, it's implicit. Why is it implicit? منع من ظهورها. What prevented the kasra from being made explicitly clear is التعذر. The third, رأيت الفتى. الفتى here, it's a مفعول به. And so it's going to be منصوب. وعلامة نصبه الفتحة المقدرة. An implicit فتحة. منع من ظهورها. منع من ظهورها التعذر. طيب. The second reason could be what we call thiqal, heaviness. Sometimes when you have a ya, putting a kasra on the ya, when the ya is in the state of sukun, putting a kasra on it might make it a bit more difficult or much more heavy. Likewise, putting a dhamma on the ya, especially when it occurs at the ending of the word, like al-qadhi mathalan, try to say al-qadhi, it's quite difficult, right? Try to say al-qadhi, it's also quite difficult. And so because it is thiqal, because it is heaviness, the word qadi, which means judge, when I put it in the state of raf, like ja'a al-qadi, or when I put it in the state of khaf, marartu bil qadi, the sign of raf and the sign of khaf here, it is a dhamma and a kasra respectively, but this dhamma and this kasra are implicit. Why is it implicit? Because mana'a min dhuhuriha al-thiqalu, what prevented the dhamma and the kasra from becoming explicitly clear is heaviness. We don't want to put the dhamma and the kasra on the word al-qadhi, on the ya at the end of al-qadhi, because it will make it much more heavy to pronounce. However, when it comes to the fatha, because the fatha is the lightest of the harakat, it is the lightest of the vowels, therefore you can put it on a ya and there won't be any problem. And so when someone says to you ra'aytu al-qadhiya, that's valid. And so you can say here for al-qadhi that it is what? مفعول به منصوب وعلامة نصبه الفتحة الظاهرة. And so it's explicit when it comes to the فتحة. Just like زيد. رأيت زيدا رأيت القاضية. طيب. The third potential reason of why implicit إعراب occurs is what we call اشتغال المحل بالحركة المناسبة. Here, I gave you an example of غلام. غلام, when I want to add the boy, غلام means boy, when I want to attach this boy to myself, and I want to say this is my boy, I say this is my غلام, غلامي. And so I have a غلام attached onto it, a ya, ya المتكلم, the ya that denotes me, طيب, my boy. You see? However, in order for this ya المتكلم to be attached onto غلام, it's a must, it is necessary that the meme is in the state of كسرة. And so where the ضمه is supposed to go when I put غلامي in the context of مرفوع, or when I put غلام in the context of منصوب, or when I put غلام in the context of مجرور, what I expect is that the حركة, the sign of the رفع and the sign of the نصب and the sign of the جر, to fall on the غلام. But because I'm attaching غلام with ياء المتكلم, and ياء المتكلم is so powerful in that it forces the ميم to have a كسرة for the ya to attach, we say that the mahal, the place where the dhamma and the kasra and the fatha is supposed to go, it's already been taken up. It's already been taken up by that kasra that's needed in order to conjoin the ya al-mutakallim to the word ghulam. And so when I say to you, ja'a ghulami, ghulam here, it's a fa'il and it is marfu', wa alamatu nasbihi al-dhamma. But this dhamma, it's implicit. Why is it implicit? Mana'a min zuhuriha ishtigharu al-mahalli bil-harakati al-munasibah. The reason why this dhamma could not be explicitly made apparent is because of the place where it should go. It's already been taken up and used up by the kasra in order to accommodate for the ya al-mutakallim. طيب. Likewise, marartu bi ghulami. Ghulami here, in this case ghulami, ghulam here will be ism majrur. Wa alamatu jarrihi al-kasra. Wa alamatu jarrihi al-kasra. طيب and of course the kasra is مقدرة منع من ظهورها اشتغال المحل بالحركة المناسبة. The reason why, because the kasra on غلامي is not because of the jar, rather it's because of the need for it in order to conjoin the ya المتكلم onto غلامي. That's why the كسرة هي it's مقدرة. طيب. Then you have the case when you put غلامي in a state of نصب. And so you say رأيت غلامي. And so here غلام طيب here it is also مكسور. But it should be مفتوح because it's منصوب. The sign of it should be a فتحة because it's منصوب. The reason why that is not the case is because اشتغال المحل بالحركة المناسبة. طيب. And so you say رأيت غلامي. غلامي here will be the غلام part will be a مفعول به منصوب. وعلامة نصبه الفتحة المقدرة an implicit فتحة. What prevented the فتحة from becoming explicit? منع من ظهورها اشتغال المحل بالحركة المناسبة. And we call غلام أي مضاف and we call the ياء المتكلم أي مضاف إليه. والله تعالى أعلم. And so this is a summary of implicit إعراب. There are three reasons why implicit إعراب occurs. التعذر, الثقل, and اشتغال المحل بالحركة المناسبة. And I have given you examples for each one. والله ولينا وحسبنا ونعم الوكيل. And so now we can discuss the categories of al-i'rab. Before we actually hit the categories of al-i'rab, it's important that we understand that al-i'rab is something that is done for asma' and something that is done with af'al mudari'ah. And so when we look at the concept of al-i'rab, and we'll see it later inshallah, what we deal with are fi'l mudari' and asma'. Therefore, what we call harf and what we call fi'l madi and what we call fi'l amr, they are all what? They are not discussed in the issues of al-i'rab. So i'rab deals with the asma' and the af'al al-mudari'ah. It does not deal with the ahruf, i.e. the huruf, neither does it deal with the madi, neither does it deal with the amr. That's important. The categories of i'rab are four: raf', nasb, khafd, and jazm. Raf' is done and it's applied in the asma' and the af'al. So it occurs in both the asma' and the af'al. Nasb also occurs on the asma' and the af'al. So nasb can occur on the ism and it can also occur on the fi'l. So I can put a fi'l in the state of nasb, I can also put an ism in the state of nasb. I can put an ism in the state of raf', I can also put fi'l in the state of raf'. When it comes to khafd, however, I can only put an ism in that scenario. I can only put ism under the action of a khafd. I cannot put a fi'l under the action of khafd. And the fourth is al-jazm. And al-jazm is only applicable upon af'al. So I cannot put an ism under the state of jazm. So I can't say ismun majzum. I can't do that. Neither can I say fi'lun makhfud. I can't do that either. Which is why one of the primary signs of the noun is what? Al-khafd. One of the primary signs of the noun is al-khafd, as we mentioned in the previous lesson. And so you have four categories to al-i'rab: al-raf'u, wal-nasbu, wal-khafdu, wal-jazm. The raf' enters upon the asma' and the af'al. The nasb enters upon the asma' and the af'al. The khafd only enters upon the asma' and the jazm only enters upon the af'al. And so everything that I have mentioned to you is summarized by the author رحمه تعالى in this chapter where he says باب الإعراب. الإعراب هو تغيير أواخر الكلم لاختلاف العوامل الداخلة عليها لفظا أو تقديرا. And so as you can see inshallah that this part here, تغيير, is the first part of our definition, changing. The second part of the definition is أواخر الكلم, where this changing occurs, the ending of the words. لفظا أو تقديرا is the third part of the definition, that it's explicit or implicit. And the reason why it's explicit or implicit, or the reason why there is a change, is لاختلاف العوامل الداخلة عليها, due to changes in the scenarios or the factors that enter upon said terminologies or said word. That is the definition of al-i'rab. Then the author رحمه الله, he mentioned to us the categories of al-i'rab. وأقسامه أربعة: رفع ونصب وخفض وجزم. رفع, نصب, خفض, and جزم. And then he mentioned where in these four categories do the asma and the af'al lie. So when it comes to the rafa' and the nasb, they enter upon or they are found in the asma and the af'al. As for the khafd, they are only found in the asma, and the jazm is only found in the af'al. And the author rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned this to us by saying فَلِلْ أَسْمَاءِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ الرَّفْعُ وَالنَّصْبُ وَالْخَفْضُ وَلَا جَزْمَ فِيهَا وَلِلْأَفْعَالِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ الرَّفْعُ وَالنَّصْبُ وَالْجَزْمُ وَلَا خَفْضَ فِيهَا وَاللَّهُ تَعَالَى أَعْلَمُ. We'll stop here بإذن الله. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.